Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today or yesterday, by the time you're watching this video, Apple released iPadOS 15 Beta 1. This is available to developers, and Apple has said that the public beta version will be out in July. They didn't give a date, but it could be around when they have Beta 2 or 3 based on what they've done in the past. So I'm running this on the new 2021 M1 iPad Pro 12.9 inch, but they also released this alongside iOS 15 Beta 1, WatchOS 8 Beta 1, and also tvOS 15 Beta 1 and macOS Monterey. So all of those are released now as Beta 1. You can download them if you're a developer. Now, the good thing is the supported devices are the same as iPadOS 14. So if you have an iPad Air 2, like I have here, all the way up to the newest iPad Pro 12.9 inch fifth generation, all of the same exact devices are supported with iPadOS 15. This is great news. And so everything that was with iPadOS 14 is supported in iPadOS 15, all of the same devices. Now, as you can see on the iPad Pro, it came in at 3.06 gigabytes and was a pretty quick download. Apple may have updated their servers. It was pretty fast to download, but it did take a while to install. Now let's take a look at the build number and then we'll talk about what's new. So we'll go to settings, then we'll go to general and then about. And if we tap on the version number, you'll see it's the same as iOS 15 19A5261W. And this particular update brings quite a few changes and updates. And in this video, I'm going to cover the major changes to iPadOS. Now, I did a separate video with iOS where many of the same features carry across, and it's about 35 minutes long of all sorts of small changes throughout. However, there's quite a few specific to iPad that I wanted to talk about. And the first one is if we go into settings and then we go down to battery, iPadOS gains low power mode. So you can turn it on or off, add it to your control center. This carries across iOS and also macOS now as well. So they've added that. They have not added the battery health though on iPadOS yet. Now the first obvious change you probably have already seen are widgets on the home screen. They're no longer just on the left. You can move them wherever you'd like. So you can put them anywhere you want, move them around, and they will rotate as you rotate the display. So if I rotate the display into portrait, they rotate along with it. So they stay just how you've placed them and sort of move around to accommodate whichever mode you have it in, portrait or landscape. They've also added additional widget sizes. So if I slide over here, you'll see one that has the Files app. So they've added some large sizes. This is for just a few different ones, such as photos, for example. But if we tap and hold, you'll see on the left, we now have App Store. So there's some new ones as well. So App Store here. We also have Files with the different size that I showed you, as well as a Mail widget. You have a couple different ones here as well for things on iOS like Sleep, for example, and even TV with a larger widget as well. So you have all of these widgets here, and it will give you suggestions about new ones. If you want to create a widget stack, you can just press and hold and drag it on top of another one, and it will create a stack. You can rotate through them and then again, press and hold, and then you can edit the stack and you have a couple options here. So you can see smart rotate on, widget suggestions on, and then you can go through your different widgets like this, just like you would before, or you can drag them back out onto the home screen. If it works properly, it is a little bit buggy. So there we go. And you can drag it onto the home screen and now it works just like you would expect. So those are new as far as widgets, being able to place them wherever you want. Another thing you may notice is if I slide over one more time, we now have the app library. So we have the app library built in. It's down here in the dock. There's a nice little animation here with that. And because we have the app library, we can now hide pages. So maybe we want to hide a page. We want to hide this one. And maybe this one, we can hide those now, hit done, and now we can hide pages. So those are now hidden, just like you can on iPhone. So it's the exact same thing there with your app library here. So it's really nice that they've added this. And again, it carries across basically very similarly to what you have on iOS now. Now with iPadOS 15, there's some changes to Safari as well. So if I go into Safari, it looks a little bit different than the version we have on iPhone, for example. So at the top, we have some new tabs. It looks more like macOS does now. And we can go back and forth between our tabs, for example. And then if we tap on the sidebar, we have some new options. So we've got four tabs, private, and then new tabs. So if we go to new tabs, we have a home screen and we've got a start page as well. So it's very much like macOS now. So you've got that. We'll go back to our tabs and you can create a tab group as well. So we can take those four tabs and create a tab group. And then we could name this Apple, for example. So we'll name it Apple, hit OK. And now we have a tab group named Apple. We can go back to our start page and we can customize the start page and again, go back to Apple. So we have that. We also have the ability to add extensions, or we will in the future anyway. We can add extensions within Safari, just like we can on macOS, for example, and that will carry across to iPhone as well. So we'll have that option in iPadOS 15. Now, one thing you may have already noticed at the top, there's three dots. If I tap on the three dots, we now have multitasking here. Now, this is a little bit different than we had before. We have full screen, we have split view, or we have the sidebar here, or slide over as they call it. So if we tap on split view, it slides it over to the right. And because there's not another app with it, we can tap on it and bring it back. But if we want to create a split view with this, it will remember that. So maybe we'll do music here and you'll see it's split with music. It's going to take a moment to load and we can go into music. We can tap the three dots on the top of either one and bring it over to slide over here, and slide over can be edited on either side. So if we tap on it again, we can bring it back over into split view if we want. Now, if I tap the three dots again, we can go back to slide over. If we tap again, we can go back to split view. And then also if I go into the multitasking window, I can actually slide parts of these off of the screen to bring it back to a full screen app. So if I want to get rid of music and split view, I just swipe it out of the way and the app goes back to full screen. So that's new in this update. So it's a little bit different and I think it's a nice little change. It makes it much more clear or much clearer as far as what you need to do with split view and slide over and things like that. Also, if you have a bunch of split view or slide over windows, slide over will show to the right also. So maybe we'll go into Safari, we'll bring up music again, and maybe we'll just leave it as slide over. If we go back into the multitasker, slide over windows will be on the right. And again, we can just swipe them off the screen. So it's a little change with multitasking there. There's also something called the shelf in different apps. So for example, if I go into Pages, so we'll go into Pages. Now within Pages at the bottom, you can now see the new shelf. And this will show you all of the different documents open within an application, for example. So if we tap on it, it goes away. If you swipe up, tap on Pages, they come back. You can open a new window, maybe switch between each one, go back and forth, and go back to whatever you'd like. Tap on the document, it goes away. Again, swipe up, and they come back. And this works across all different apps with multiple windows open, for example. In Notes, for example, it will show up as well. So that's something a little bit new. Now on the keyboard, there's some changes as well. So if I go into a note, for example, now within a note, if I press and hold, maybe right here, we tap on it. Let me just tap and press and hold my finger. You'll see that there's a little loop here now, just like we had before, that magnifies things so I can understand what I'm pressing and holding on. Let me bring that up closer so I can show you. And you'll see just like we had years ago, if you want to select something, it makes it much easier to see what your thumb or your finger is covering. So this is something they've actually brought back and I'm very grateful to see it here. Now, in addition to the loop, we also have some additional options if you're using an external keyboard. You basically can use the iPad without ever lifting your hands off the keyboard. So if I grab a Magic Trackpad or a Magic Keyboard rather, now with the Magic Keyboard, if I press and hold on the globe, you'll see it'll pop open a little dialogue that tells us the different screen shortcuts on our display. Now, this varies depending what app you're in, and they've added a lot to it. Before we had this, but now it's much more comprehensive of the whole OS. So multitasking, for example, or you can actually search. So maybe you want to look for, how do I open settings? Well, there isn't a keyboard shortcut for it. However, Control Center there is, and you tap on the globe and hit C. So if we do that, globe C, now we've got the Control Center that pops down. So it shows us whatever app we're in. If we go back into Notes, press and hold, do the same thing. Now it's telling us the different notes for things like slide over, split view, multitasking, and the system. There's a lot more keyboard shortcuts in this particular version. Now within Mail and Notes, we have a new option as well. So maybe we're working on something, we want something in the center of the window, we'll go into Mail, press and hold, and we can go to open in a new window. Now you can also do this in split view as well, but you'll see it here, and maybe we want to tap back here. We now have our shelf at the bottom where we can switch between bringing the email to focus or switching back to our inbox. We can go back and forth and it will show us either one. So it's easy to go back and forth between them now, and you can do that in notes as well with your shelf, as well as bringing it center focus. So again, if I go into Safari and then we bring in email or bring in mail, again, if I press and hold, we can now bring that to the center of the display with both open and split view, for example. And so it's a nice little update to make things a little bit more focused for us. Now within Notes, they've added some collaboration tools. Now you could already collaborate with multiple people on a note, but what they've added is the ability for someone to notate something. And then when you leave Notes and come back later to sort of see what's going on with it, you can see a list of all the changes that have been made by swiping in from the right. Also, people can mention you specifically using the at symbol, and you can see where they need you to change something for whatever you're working on. So those have been added within Notes. However, on the home screen, if we go here, within the OS overall, there's a new system called Quick Notes. So if we take the Apple Pencil, we can also use a different control center button as well, and also a keyboard gesture. But if we swipe in from the bottom right, we have Quick Notes. And maybe we want to use that Quick Note in Safari. You'll see a little note popped up, and you'll see here that there's a link. I actually copied this link earlier, and then I have a note here as well. And I can update the note that I copied some text from here. So you can make notes about this particular image. We can paste or copy and paste or drag and drop different images into our notes here. And now we have that image in our note. So it's throughout the whole OS and any app you're in. So if I go into, say, my mail again, bring in Notes, I have Quick Notes here, and I can add a link to this email itself. So it's universal across the OS. And as you go out of it, it swipes over to the right, and maybe we're done with the Quick Note and it goes away. So it's a nice little update throughout the OS. Now I mentioned this in the iOS update video, but Translate has been added to the entire OS as well. So if I go back into Safari and I press and hold on this word powerful here, I can translate this into something else. So you have to turn it on and then select the language you want, such as Spanish, and it translates it on the fly. So now it's translated into whatever language you want that's supported. So you've got English, French, German, Mandarin, Chinese, Portuguese, Russian, Korean, Italian, and maybe there'll be more eventually after that, Arabic as well. So you can translate that on the fly anywhere in the OS. You also can look up something. So you have the option to look up the word powerful using Spotlight search, and it understands what it is and then finds things that are related, whether that be the dictionary or movies and more. So that's built into the whole OS on iPadOS and iOS as well. Now the Books app gets a small update to search. So if we go in here and we go to search, there's a new update to search to help you find things, such as Harry Potter, for example. And so search has been updated to look a little bit different. It's a minor change, but it is something worth noting since it's different on the iPad. Now, a big thing they demoed at WWDC was what's called universal control. That allows you to use a trackpad like this one here, a Magic trackpad or a keyboard across all your devices, your Mac to your iPad to your MacBook, and you can just drag your finger over from one to the next to the next. You place your iPad next to a MacBook, for example, and then you can click and drag anything from your iPad over to the Mac or from the Mac to the iPad. You can work seamlessly between them. And when I have macOS up and running, I'll try this out more, but you can use a mouse or a keyboard or anything that works between these devices, and it will work seamlessly automatically. It should be really easy to set up, and it works across all the devices. So it's worth mentioning. It's something I can't wait to use more in depth once I'm on macOS and updated that as well with the beta. Now the voice memo app gets some updates as well. So maybe you have a new voice memo recording. In the upper right, we have some new playback options. So we can speed up the voice memo, or we can skip silence. So maybe we recorded a long lecture, we want to skip all the silent parts, we can just turn that on and then play it back at maybe a faster speed. So we'll hit play. There we go. And then also we can share multiple recordings at once. So if we edit, now we can share those selected recordings at once. So that's what's new in voice memos. Now, as far as accessibility is concerned, there's some updates as well. There's quite a few that are in iOS, but in iPadOS specifically, you now have the option for additional third-party devices that will help you use your eyes to track on the iPad, for example. So it now has eye tracking support for third-party MFI hardware that's supported on iPad. So you'll be able to use your eyes to use the cursor, and you can dwell to perform certain actions like tap, scroll, or swipe. So that's something that has been added. Of course, you would need one of those devices with iPadOS to use that. Of course, this gains all of the voiceover changes and all of the other things I mentioned in the iOS video as well. Now, on the iPad, Apple announced a major change today for those using just an iPad that are not using a computer and use Swift Playgrounds. So maybe you're using Swift Playgrounds and you want to create an app. You've learned how to code within Swift Playgrounds, and you want to create your own app, you can now do that on the iPad. You can build it. And then also you have all of the improved code completion that you get with Xcode, or at least most of it, as well as access to all the UI components and documentation with it. You can then run it on the iPad and submit it to the App Store. So from start to finish, in theory, you can create your entire app on the iPad itself. So this is a big change. It's a huge step forward, and I'm glad they're actually doing that. So that's something that's coming a little bit later, it seems, with Swift Playgrounds and Swift UI. So that's a huge change for this. And those are all the major changes with iPadOS 15. Now there's a bunch of other things that I didn't mention with messages and notifications, for example. So there's some changes there to the overall way that works, as well as a new focus mode that you have options for that I talked about in iOS as well. So if you want to see all the other things I mentioned, be sure to check out the iOS 15 update video as well. So that's everything that's major and different in iPadOS. Now, if you found anything else, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Of course, there's going to be quite a few other small changes here and there that I didn't mention, and I'll continue to update you on those as soon as I know as well. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.